church family, this is Brother Jacques with your New Hope Minute. And right off, I want to remind you about an awesome opportunity to serve God and our community right here at New Hope. Our food ministry is going to be packing boxes on Tuesday, May 17th at 8 a.m. and handing that food out that afternoon from 5 to 6 p.m. Come be a part of this awesome ministry. And speaking of ministry, don't forget about our Vacation Bible School this year, June 26th through the 30th. We still need volunteers to help us make this year the best one ever, so see Sister Haley Whitmire to volunteer. And finally, graduates and parents, please don't forget about the Graduate Sunday on May 22nd. If your student's graduating this year, I need their pictures as soon as possible so we can be ready to celebrate what God is doing in their lives. God bless you all, and remember, we love you here at New Hope.
Stand with us this morning, and as we sing this first song, this is an old hymn, and I want you to really listen to the words of it and try to hear it with fresh ears this morning as we sing Victory in Jesus.
To each and every one of you, we're so thankful that you're here to worship with us and be a part of this family at New Hope this morning. In a moment here, we're going to have our time of altar prayer, but we do have a lot going on in the life of our fellowship. I hope that you watch the New Hope Minute and you know what's coming up this week. Look in that bulletin, but just to highlight that, remember that Vacation Bible School is going to be here before we know it, and we need those teachers and we need those workers and leaders in every area. So please see Sister Haley Whitmire. Let her know you're willing to serve. Guys, Vacation Bible School is oftentimes one of the most evangelistic things that we can do, because we go out into this community and we bring those children in, and that's the interaction with the gospel they might have that whole year. So let's take that seriously and be a part of that ministry. Food ministry this week on Tuesday is coming up as well. Got a lot to pray about, a lot to pray for, people that have experienced great loss this week. So just here in a moment, as the music continues playing, this altar is open. Let's pray together as a church family now. Let's pray. Father God, so many people inside our fellowship are dealing with loss and dealing with struggles, Father God. And we pray your touch of blessings in those that have experienced loss, Father. We pray your hand of healing in those that are dealing with sickness. But in all of us, Father God, we pray that you draw us in this time of worship closer to your throne. You are great and you are holy. Help us to worship you as you truly deserve. Help us to carry this gospel out of this building and into this world, because it is what you've called us to do. Father, we love you, we thank you, and it is in your blessed, holy, and perfect name we pray together. Amen. God bless you. We love you here at New Hope.
My life, you have been so, so good. Oh! you, Lord. You may be seated.
Children can be dismissed to children's church with me today.
Memories. Thank you, brother. I say brings back old memories because it's been a few days since I could run and play like that. I appreciate Joseph. Brother, you just don't know. I appreciate you and really all the musicians and singers. It's I have known people that you can tell by the look on their face, it's a chore to be at church. And then there are others that you can look at their face and tell, I'm glad I'm here. I'd rather be here than in jail. I'd rather be here than intensive care. Thank you. Sir, or at the funeral home? Well, now if you're genuinely a Christian, that means you've gone to be with the Lord. That could be positive, but not everybody's a Christian. You realize that. I'm in Philippians 2, 5 through 11. I want to read a little text here, and one of the many things I like about our Sunday school teacher, Brother Johnny, he's got always a little something humorous in there, and I got a touch of humor, every now and then. Today's sermon is Making Jesus Lord. Jesus Lord goes together in the Bible. I really don't believe he can be your Lord unless, first of all, he's your Savior. So Jesus as your Savior and your Lord. Now, what does Lord mean? Kyrios in the Greek means the boss, the master, the ruler. The boss, the master, the ruler. When you're born again, he comes in and he lives within your heart. But then who controls your life? If Jesus is not Lord, you're not living a Christian life. I mean, you got to do better. Well, let's read the text, and then we'll jump in here. Philippians 2, verses 5 through 11. I'm New King James, if that matters to anybody. Verse 5, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God also has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, which at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of those in heaven, those on earth, of those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, by your providence, there were people many years ago who paid the price to establish this church. And even in recent years, there has been much work and much money spent to make this place attractive and conducive to worship. But in spite of all this, Lord, we need your Holy Spirit to come and just sit with us a spell. Lord, I pray that you might preach through this word, and there might be somebody here today realizing they need to come and receive Jesus Christ as their Savior. And I pray also for many Christians who would say, in all honesty, he's not really the master of my life. He's not really the ruler of my life. He's not really the Lord of my life. And Lord, perhaps in invitation time, there'll be another altar call, and we'll come to this altar and say, Jesus, I want you to be Lord of my life. Again, thank you for the worship we've had already. I pray that you speak this morning and that we be attentive, be listening, and hear what you want us to say. And we thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. I start with a smile because I already read this. Carlos McLeod, I read this, a book that he wrote, but anyhow, I read this. Carlos McLeod got on an airplane in Butte, Montana, headed for Dallas, Texas. There was a husband next to him and his wife three rows ahead. The couple was obviously in the midst of turmoil. The husband began to curse his wife, the airline, life, and everybody in general. After venting his frustration, he sailed a little and asked Carlos, "And what do you do?" The reply, "I'm a Baptist preacher." There was a long silence. So his wife rekindled the arguments. Evidently, she knew more profanity than her husband. The husband politely asked her, "Be quiet." Finally, he told her, "Shut up." Still, no let up in the foul mouth. So the husband said, as a last chance, "Dear, this is Carlos McLeod. He's a Baptist preacher." After a long pause, she said, "Oh, I'm a Baptist." Folks, you can't make stuff like this up. This really happened. I guess I've been a Baptist preacher 60 years. Lordy mercy. I have known some people like this. I have been the pastor of some people like this. And it wasn't an easy job either. I'm telling you that saying you're a Baptist is not the total answer. You know it, don't you? I heard an old boy say one time, you know, those denominational labels either blow off going up or burn off going down. I'm thinking he probably had it pegged. Denomination, Baptist or otherwise, denomination doesn't make you right with God. The blood of Jesus Christ applied to your repenting, believing soul is what makes you right with God. And I've seen it happen in some unusual places. It doesn't have to always happen at church. I'm real unusual places. Well, Jesus being Savior is primary. I've already told you that. But if you're saved and Jesus is not the Lord, I'm talking about the boss, the ruler of your life, then you've just simply... You've got a problem. Well, I was a seminary student in a student pastorate across the lake, across Pontchartrain from New Orleans. The first time I heard a person, I'm not saying male or female, I always get in trouble when I do that, a person began to use profanity in the business meeting. Now, folks, I want to tell you, I spent some time in a bar room, and I was a longshoreman in New Orleans on the freight dock. And I promise you, I heard some words on the freight dock that I did not learn in Sunday school. But now, when it comes to God's house, I really believe this is God's house. We just don't use language like that around God's house. Me personally, if I was on an airline, I wouldn't use that kind of language. We have got to somehow realize we got to be saved, and Jesus has got to be the Lord, boss, master, ruler of our life. Well, reading through, I guess it was just recently, last few days, Solomon built the temple. David went on to be with his people. And God said to Solomon, David's son, I want you to build this temple, this place of worship, not yourself, David. And I've read stories about adultery. I've read stories about murder by proxy. I've read stories about things in the family. And then God has the audacity to say, this was a man after my own heart. Well, now listen, folks, I'm not perfect and you're not perfect. But I'm saying I believe old David kind of crossed the line there a time or two or three. And yet, the umbrella over David's life was he was a man who loved the Lord. You know what? That gives me hope. When I mess up, Miss Barbara, we're not having testimonies this morning. When I mess up, she's precious. She keeps me mostly on the straight here. I mess up. I sin. The blood of Jesus Christ cleanses from all sin. Folks, I want to tell you, this is just gut level. This is me to you. If I were not all confessed up right with God, I would not get on I-20. I'm just being serious. You know, this morning's lesson, I talked for Brother Johnny. He's out of town. That rapture's coming. You know, the shout, the voice of the archangel, the trumpet blow, and we're going, that's coming. I want to be prepared. There are stories. Jesus tells story after story after story about people given responsibility and not being responsible, and their master comes, and they're not ready. I suspect strongly, we were discussing on the way over this morning, I actually started doing some supply preaching here in May last year. It's been a year. Lord have mercy. Time flies, doesn't it? Well, I don't really know you that well, and you really don't know me that well, but I'm just telling you, if Jesus is not Savior and Lord of your life, this is the day. This is the day. I remember the first time that I preached on tithing, I've preached on tithing a lot. The first time I preached on tithing, and some little guy came forward to make a profession of faith. Hey, what God's Spirit tells you may not be at anything to do with what I'm talking about. You listen to God's Holy Spirit, okay? I had a grown man married with children, a grown man walk the aisle, take out his checkbook. You know, guys, that's where it goes right there, next to our heart. Take out his checkbook, put it on the altar, and say, I want to dedicate my checkbook to the Lord. You know, after they revived me, I thought, you know, this guy really wants Jesus to be the Lord. I mean, if he's Lord of my checkbook, it's pretty serious. Hey, what about the plastic? Got some of those plastic cards in your pocket? Is Jesus Lord of the plastic? Yeah. Amen or oh me. Shouldn't say this out in public, but it is what it is. I'm a true Luddite. You just look it up, Luddite. We have no computer. We don't even have cable TV. We got an antenna stuck up there behind the TV on the wall on a nail. We're rich folks. I hear stories from people, some counseling and some just hear stories. There are people watch things on their TV that even if they're a Baptist, they ought not to be looking at. I hear stories. One of my best friends, minister, was involved in pornography for a long time, and it's just no good. Has started a ministry, mostly to men, because he's a guy, dealing with guys that are hooked on pornographic material. Now, even if you're a Baptist, this is not something that you need to be putting in your mind. And I digress, but I promise you'll get out on time. I was in a ministerial association over in Aberdeen, Mississippi. All denominations. I still think all them labels are going to blow off or burn off. You know, we were in a ministerial association. This is way back when. And one of our ministers, not a Baptist, but one of our ministers, good man, we had trouble in town with magazines and little children that could see the magazines because they're out there in the open stand. And so at one of our meetings, this guy had gone around and bought up some magazines, and I'm not talking Field and Stream. I realize we're a mixed audience here. Bought a bunch of magazines. Lewd. Anyhow, we're around this table, a bunch of preachers, and he just threw these magazines, just like you throw dominoes out there. Can I tell you right now? God is my witness. It was as real in my brain as it is if it was this morning. You get trash in your brain, it stays. The only thing I know that will get trash out of your brain is the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. Folks, I'm telling you, is Jesus the Lord of your house, your family, your work, your vehicles? One of my mentors, old Mike Gilchrist out of Shreveport, Mike says, if Jesus is not Lord of all, he is not Lord at all. Put on your thinking cap. If he's not Lord of all, he's not Lord at all. What did I say Lord was? The boss, the ruler. He controls everything. We have this fancy new machine came with our TV called a remote control. Barbara, they're laughing at me. There are some commercials that come on, and I'm watching a good show. There are some commercials that come on that are gross. And whichever one is the closest, just get the mute button. That's my favorite channel, the mute button. I've said it before right here. Trash in, trash out, you know. Let this mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus. Did I just read that? Let this mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus. I remember hearing Ruth Bell Graham, Billy Graham's wife, back years ago, say, if God doesn't destroy America, he owes Sodom and Gomorrah an apology. Folks, that's nitty-gritty. That's right down to, this is bottom line. And I hate to tell you, some of those people doing some of those things are Baptist. Is Jesus Savior? Is Jesus Lord? He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. I cannot imagine the sinless Son of God coming to earth to start with, taking upon himself flesh and blood and going through the temptations. The Bible says he was tempted at all points like we are tempted, yet without sin. And then he died on the cross to take our place, brothers and sisters. He died on that cross to take our place. Humiliation. There are videos, there are movies about Christ and about the cross. And I'm telling you, and I've studied a little bit, crucifixion is the most inhumane way of capital punishment there's ever been. The guillotine, where you lop their head off, I mean, it's done in an instant. Crucifixion could take many hours, basically suffocate. Just awful. In his humiliation, then there was the exaltation. God's given him a name that's above every other name. That of the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, every tongue should confess. Heaven, earth, under the earth. I'll save that for another sermon. Jesus said, all power is given to me in heaven and earth. He knew exactly what he was saying. All power. He's the one. Well, if the humiliation was good and the exaltation was good, I think that I need to be faithful and obedient to the Lord. There's been a time or two in my life, I mean just a time or two, when Jesus said, you need to do this, and I just didn't want to do it. And I'm not going to ask for a show of hands. It happens. God says, I want you to do this, and somehow I didn't. Boy, you know the Lord is all-powerful. Sometimes you go kicking and screaming, but you better do what God tells you to do, or you'll end up in big trouble. Well, if he says this, we ought to be obligated to do this. And I just made a quick list. I love this. Matthew 28:19, go and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go and teach. John 13:34, love one another. Now, why would a church, John 13:34, why would a church need to be told to love each other? If Jesus is Savior, if Jesus is Lord, we ought to love each other. And I have shared with you before, Miss Barbara and I have a growing love relationship. I know we're old timers, but we learn, you know. Agape is the real word, God's love, means, and I know I've shared this, but it's just relevant. When I say I love you, I'm really saying, how can I help you? What can I do for you? How can I make your life a better life to live? When I'm saying I love you, I'm saying, what can I do to make it better for you? Y'all gonna love this. Guys, put on your side armor there so that she doesn't get you with an elbow. This morning before daylight, I was doing dishes. Now, I don't have dishpan hands. She puts them in the washer at night before we go to bed, and this thing magically washes them during the night, and I get up early, and I take them out and put them on the shelves. Now, that's just a simple little thing. If y'all could see what I see from up here, you'd have to laugh. There are some ladies have leaned over and talked to their husband. I'm sorry, guys. I'm sorry. Now, let me reciprocate. When it comes time to mow the grass, it's about a three-hour job. She mows the front and I mow the back. She helps me with some of my chores too, okay? This goes both ways. When you say I love you, you're saying, what can I do to make your life better? What can I do to help you? What can I do to encourage you? Jesus says we're to love one another. Just came to my mind. It's not in my notes. I had an old boy that was chairman of deacons one time. Now, Stephen, I'm not talking to you. Matthew, I'm not talking to you. I had an old boy one time that was chairman of deacons, and I honestly believe he belonged to the devil and he was working for the devil. I'm just telling it like it is. When Jesus says we're supposed to love one another, we need to be helping, encouraging, whatever. John 15:10, keep my commandments. You can take all that back to Exodus chapter 20. Keep all my commandments. I told the Sunday school class this morning, excuse me. For the most part of my life, I've been a law-abiding citizen. Those Ten Commandments were written in stone. They weren't a suggestion. That's God's law. It's not optional. Keep my commandments. Number four, Malachi 3:10. I guess you knew this would be in here. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse. Golly gee. It's been in print because I've read it that about 20% of the members of a Baptist church give about 80% of the money. Well, you realize somebody's not carrying their part of the load, don't you? I mean, that's the statistics. Bring all the tithes. Romans 12:15. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Steve, we've been there. I guess I'm more emotional. I'm more prone to hurt with people that hurt. But don't we need one another when we're hurting? Yes, we do. And I like to rejoice with people who rejoice. 1 Peter 1:16, be holy, for I am holy. Yeah, that's an oh me. I can't speak for you. I know me a lot better. And I'm just a notch or two below holy. Yeah, you know, don't you? I'm back to that thing up there. The blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin. 1 Peter 3:8. Finally, all of you be of one mind, having compassion for one another, love as brothers, tender-hearted and courteous. I have known some Baptist people that were not courteous. Should I just press on? Those who know Jesus best call him Lord. These apostles and early close followers, their favorite term was not Jesus or teacher, rabbi, although it was used. Their favorite expression is Lord. And throughout the New Testament, Savior and Lord, just peanut butter and jelly, Savior and Lord just go together. The observation of the outsiders, he taught them as one having authority, not like the scribes and Pharisees. Even his enemies We're talking at the foot of the cross. Never a man spoke like this man. History, I think, revolves around Jesus Christ. The blind could see, the deaf could hear, the lame could walk, the dead rose after Jesus spoke. This was no ordinary guy. Thomas confessed in the upper room the second time when he saw with his own eyes and maybe felt with his own hand, "My Lord and my God, my Lord, my boss, my God." I'd like to ask a very simple question, and we press on. This morning, is Jesus your Savior? If you drew your last breath and fell over dead right here in the chair, is Jesus your Savior? That's a done deal. If he's not, during the invitation, I need to talk to you. And I guess Jock is here or will be here. I don't know. I saw him leave. We need to talk to you about praying and receiving Christ as your Savior today. Not tomorrow, not next week, today. And quite frankly, you're in church on Sunday morning. Can I give you an A+? You're not bad people. You're in church on Sunday morning. That's good. But there's an area in your life, and it may have nothing to do with anything I mentioned. There's an area in your life that Jesus is not the Lord of. He's not the boss of. Friend, I want to tell you, you can't sneak off far enough that God doesn't know what you're doing. You cannot sneak off far enough that he doesn't know what you're doing. Today you may want to just come kneel at the altar and you're saying, well, what will people think? They say, he's honest. She's honest. Because quite frankly, sometimes I don't do what I'm supposed to do. You know, if they want to think whatever, that's between them and the Lord. Today, if Jesus is not Lord of any area in your life, boy, I love this new altar. Carpet. Today is the day to get right with God. Not tomorrow. I heard the old boy say one time, you know, it's always today with God. It's always tomorrow with a fool. Oh, dear precious friends, you're not a fool. Today is a day to get right with God. Let's pray together. Our Father, we thank you for just a clear reminder. We're not what we ought to be, but it's not over yet. There's that lost one today that needs to be saved. There's that Christian that's got an area in his or her life that Jesus is not the Lord of, and you're not happy with them. Lord, today I pray you bless this time of invitation for Jesus' sake. Amen. The precious blood of
Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is come. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Again, for being here. God's good. God's good. Amen. And we got things. The calendar through the summer is full. Just be faithful. Wherever. You know, be faithful. Anything else before we go? You're good. Somebody somewhere has got lunch prepared. I got up at 4 this morning, and I don't want to tell you, it's been a little while since breakfast. I love y'all, and it's not I love you, but if I can help enhance, make your life better, I'm here to help, here to serve. We, God bless you. Brother Charlie Barber, why? Just what can I say? Love you, brother. Would you pray for us?